الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له نحمده بما هو أهله هو أهل التقوى وأهل المغفرة ربنا وسعت كل شيء رحمة وعلما فاغفر الذين تابوا واتبعوا سبيلك وقهم عذاب الجحيم وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله لم يتخذ صاحبة ولا ولدا له ما في السماوات وما في الأرض وهو القاهر فوق عباده وإليه المصير نعلم خائنة الأعين وما تخفي الصدور خلقكم فأحسن صوركم وأشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدا صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم عبده ورسوله هو الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة وإن كانوا من قبل لفي ضلال مبين وآخرين منهم لما يلحقوا بهم وهو العزيز الحكيم. ذلك فضل الله يؤتيه من يشاء والله ذو الفضل العظيم. أما بعد, sisters and brothers, committed Muslims, Allah says with His guiding word, about which there should be no doubt, for those who know better, about which there is no doubt. He says, and this is so telling of our time, even though the names may be different, but the roles are the same. إن فرعون وهامان وجنودهما كانوا خاطئين. In this ayah, Allah is underscoring, He is emphasizing the fact that the Pharaoh and his assistant and his troops were wrong and aggressive. Why, if Allah Azza wa Jal is telling us with the advantage of the time distance that separates us from that reality, so that we can soak our minds with the correct information, so that we may not be emotionally involved with such a ruler, with the benefit of hindsight, Allah offers us this information. And when He does, we are incapable of processing this information within the time and the space we occupy in our lifespan. إِنَّ فِرْعَوْنَ وَهَامَانَ وَجُنُودَهُمَا كَانُوا خَاطِئِينَ. Notice that Allah brought to our attention a ruler, a decision maker, an authority that was, in terms of power, second to none in this world. There are no other rulers or kings or emperors or autocrats at the time who could compete with this ruler. That's the first observation in the area. Do we have a parallel ruler in our time? This is where our thinking kicks in. Allah has presented His word of wisdom to those who think, for those who reason, for those who use their minds. How many times in the Quran has Allah said to you and to me, إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَاتٍ لِقَوْمٍ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. Indeed, in that there are, and again, there are traces of Allah's involvement. There are indications of Allah's power. إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَاتٍ لِقَوْمٍ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. For people who think. And then the word, the parallel words to يتفكرون in the Quran are يعقلون and يفقهون. For those who reason, for those who have infinite knowledge. لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ, for those who have core thoughts, original thoughts. Bring this description that Allah has given you, if you are entitled to it, if you have qualified yourself for it, bring it to this ayah. إِنَّ فِرْعَوْنَ وَهَامَانَ وَجُنُودَهُمَا كَانُوا خَاطِئِينَ. The Pharaoh. Are we to understand that this is a static ayah? An ayah that is frozen in time to the age of the Pharaoh? Or are we to understand that this is applicable? It is meaningful. It is descriptive. It is an expose of all those who have the qualities of the Pharaoh, second to none rulers in this world. Here is where the gap is. We don't find Muslims who are willing to read what Allah has to say and then understand what He is saying in terms of the facts and the realities and the particulars and details of their own lives. If Allah is saying, إِنَّ فِرْعَوْنَ وَهَامَانَ وَجُنُودَهُمَا كَانُوا خَاطِئِينَ, He is also saying everyone in the description with the qualities, the policies, the strategies of the Pharaoh qualify for the meanings of being condemned in this area. And if there's any time that we are required to understand the meanings of this ayah and its equivalent in the Quran, it is the time that we are in here and now because of what is being done to us. What did this second to none ruler in the world do? What did he do to his people? And his people were not local people. This was a world figure. What did he do? إِنَّ فِرْعَوْنَ عَلَى فِي الْأَرْضِ وَجَعَلَ أَهْلَهَا شِيَعًا. This Pharaoh figure, which lived then and lives now, عَلَى فِي الْأَرْضِ, He had an elevated status in the world. Not in a country or a region. In the known world of that time. Do we have a person that qualifies today to fill in the vacancy of the Pharaoh? If we don't think, we don't have anyone. If we begin to think, then we will realize who the contemporary Pharaohs are.
فرعون غلا في الأرض وجعل أهلها شيعا. And then he rendered the occupants of the earth divided segments of people. Does this ring a bell? If you think, it rings a bell. But if you don't think, you don't get it. وجعل أهلها شيعا. Look at today's world. How come we have people divided on the line? And here we go. They think in every divisive factor in human life to use against the human family to divide it. Along the lines of race, is there division in this world? Is there racial division, we ask ourselves? Are we supposed to think about these ads or not? If we are, we ask ourselves, are there racial divisions in this world? If the answer is no, you are not thinking. If the answer is yes, then who's responsible for it? Are we created with racial discrimination in our nature, in our character, or is it something that comes our way in life and then begins to fashion our behavior towards those who don't belong to quote-unquote our race? Where did this come from? Are there divisions in this world along the lines of national origin or ethnicity? If you think, you're able to see the division in this world along these lines. If you are not thinking, you just pass by this whole affair as if it doesn't exist. Take the issue of sex or religion as a matter of division in the human crowd. They render these and many other elements. Gender, if you're a man or if you're a woman, then you have to feel that you are not belonging to the other gender. Or there's some type of tension between you and the other gender. Class. If you have a certain amount of wealth, or if you lack a certain amount of wealth, that's supposed to also generate division and tension and friction. Where is all of this coming from, we ask you? Allah wants you to think where all of this is traced to. إِنَّ فِرْعَوْنَ عَلَى فِي الْأَرْضِ وَجَعَلَ أَهْلَهَا شِيَعًا يَسْتَضْعِفُ طَائِفَةً مِنْهُمْ. And then, this Pharaoh of old and of new, he takes a look at this human society, finds there are components that are weak. If these segments or populations in the world are weak, you take advantage of them. You oppress them. You steal their resources. If you are thinking of what Allah is telling you, your attention will go to areas in the world where this is happening. Aren't there wars in Africa, in Latin America, in Asia, where there are populations that are oppressed? They want the diamonds, they want the petroleum, they want the natural resources. And to get them out, if they have to kill, if they have to institutionalize tyranny, they do that. But how come they can do it and they can get away with it? Because we failed to make this a collective point of attention among us. There should be a vested public opinion, a become that public opinion, then the Pharaoh will not be able to get away with what he got away with then. What he tried to, and what he's trying to get away with here and now. وَجَعَلَ أَهْلَهَا شِيَعًا يَسْتَطْرِفُ طَائِفَةً مِنْهُمْ. It's not only there, Allah, for those of us who are slow at catching up with what he has to say. يُذَبِّحُ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ وَيَسْتَحْيِي نِسَاءَهُمْ. This strategy and these policies that were at work then and continue to be at work now, what do? They kill off the sons of people. And they did, the Pharaoh did this at that time in the case of the children of Israel, the children of Yaqub. And do we see similar policies that are happening today? Is there a policy of يُذَبِّحُونَ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ وَيَسْتَحْيُونَ نِسَاءَهُمْ? Does that policy exist today? If you don't think, you'll say it doesn't exist. If you do think, you can take an illustration of that. What is happening in Iraq? Isn't that a good example of يُذَبِّحُونَ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ وَيَسْتَحْيُونَ نِسَاءَهُمْ? يُذَبِّحُ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ وَيَسْتَحْيِي نِسَاءَهُمْ. Wars for the past 20 years, in one way or the other. And this is not the time to go into details of whether the wars are justified or not. But it is a time to look at the way the Pharaoh looks at these issues. The only superpower in the world, the way it looks at these issues. Killing off the men, the children, the male of society. Through warfare, through economic sanctions, through forced dislocations. So what's there to remain? That's a society that exemplifies what is happening to us, and we fail to see it. إِنَّ فِرْعَوْنَ عَلَى فِي الْأَرْضِ وَجَعَلَ أَهْلَهَا شِيَعًا يَسْتَضْعِفُ طَائِفَةً مِنْهُمْ يُذَبِّحُ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ وَيَسْتَحْيِي نِسَاءَهُمْ إِنَّهُ كَانَ مِنَ الْمُفْسِدِينَ. This is the nature of human corruption, chaos, mischief, troublemaking. And then Allah, when it comes to us, when we look, when we want to look and understand the realities and the facts of this world, when it comes to us, there's a barrier between our affinity with the Quran on one hand, and the fact that our highlighted in the Qur'an concerning the world on the other hand. How does Pharaoh deal with us? We're supposed to be committed Muslims. We're supposed to have at least a degree of knowledge ahead of others. But what does this Pharaoh do? How does he affect us? فَتَّحَتَّ قَوْمَهُ فَأَطَاعُوهُ إِنَّهُمْ كَانُوا قَوْمًا فَاسِقِينَ. This Pharaoh who has penetrated our minds through multiculturalism, through the melting pot idea or potpourri of people. Penetrated our minds to a degree that he's taken us slightly. Because he knows we don't take the Quran seriously, so he takes us slightly. But the Hafatomah, this Pharaoh, considers us with disregard. Look, it's present in front of you. Hundreds of people around here, they'd rather listen to senseless khutbahs than to listen to khutbahs that make sense. The meanings of the Quran are alive. If you care to understand them and assimilate them, it's not enough to have a mental freezer relationship with the Quran. It has to be a warm, working relationship with the Quran. Look at how the Pharaoh has taken his people lightly, and his people are no longer limited to one nation. Remember, there is a globalization that is in process. And now the Pharaoh can say that he is taking lightly the popular opinion of the world, because he is in a true sense now not a Pharaoh of the known world, but the Pharaoh of our world. Look how obedient people are to their pharaohs. If the pharaoh says that Islam is a matter of fanaticism and terror, then in a popular sense, those who are supposed to belong to the Quran follow the pharaoh. The mistake is to follow these pharaohs in their policies, in their strategies. Especially now, we as Muslims are not living in a time of comfort where we begin to finesse our Islam and pay or concentrate our attention on issues of brushing our teeth. Or wearing a abaya. These are the cultural issues of Islam. And in time like this, when we see, can anyone deny who's living in this world? Can anyone deny what is happening to the Muslims? It's almost like every week there is a new place in the world where bombs are being dropped on us. And the Prophet of Allah says, as he stood on the day of Arafat in Hajj, he said, "Ayyuhan nas, فَأَيُّ يَوْمٍ هَذَا؟ قَالُوا يَوْمُ الْحَرَامِ. فَأَيُّ شَهْرٍ هَذَا؟ بَلْ فَأَيُّ بَلَدٍ هَذَا؟ قَالُوا بَلَدُ الْحَرَامِ. فَأَيُّ شَهْرٍ هَذَا؟ قَالُوا شَهْرُ الْحَرَامِ. قَالْ فَإِنَّ دِمَاءَكُمْ وأعراضكم وأموالكم حرام عليكم كحرمة نومكم هذا في بلدكم هذا في شهركم هذا إلى أن تلقوا ربكم أو إلى يوم تلقون فيه ربكم. ألا فليبلغ الشاهد الغائب لا تعودوا من بعدي كفارا يضرب بعضكم رقاب بعض.
What is all of this about? This is one of the hadith that the status quo clergymen want to sweep beneath the carpet. What does the Prophet say in this hadith? And once again, looking at it and expressing it with the attendance of our minds. He stood up on the day of the 10th of the Hijjah in Mecca, and he said to the people when he performed his final Hajj, "O people, which day is this?" They said, "This is a day of sanctity." He said, "Which place is this?" They replied, "This is a place of sanctity." He asked, "Which month is this?" They answered, "This is a month of sanctity." He said then, "O people, know that your life and your possession and your honor are as sanctimonious. They have as much sanctity as this day, in this place, in this month. This is the sanctity of Muslim blood, of Muslim life." "Oh yeah. And what are these bombs and these weapons and these war fronts that are shedding and spilling Muslim blood around the world, saying to the Lord's Prophet, if you say Muslim life has a sanctity to it, these Muslims in Gaza are saying no, there's no sanctity to it. And we can prove it because Muslim blood flows." فَلْيُبَلَّغْ الشَّاهِدَ الْغَائِبَ. Let those who are present communicate this information to those who are absent. And if there was a presence and an absence of distance at that time, now there's a presence and absence of a quality of mind at this time. Because to bring this hadith into the context of our world today, we're going to be forced to look at the major pharaohs and the minor pharaohs in our lives. We're going to begin to focus on the president and the kings who are making decisions that affect our lives. They don't want us to do that. So they, as a matter of convenience, they marginalize this type of hadith. Even though it is quoted in Muslim and the Bukhari and other notable authoritative books of hadith. But they don't want you to think about this because it's going to make you think about that. This is not a matter of picking on presidents and kings. It is a matter of exposing them as a function and a responsibility
directly from the Quran and from Allah's Prophet.
But the Pharaoh enjoys the Muslim ignorance that we display. Well, these people, they don't want to think about these issues. They don't mention them. Besides, we have a network of these Muslim scholars who only express our line of thought. That's right. You come and look at this network around the world. There's been a globalization of this network that reverberates with ignorance from Mecca to Washington. And it has cost the Muslims hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of lives. From month to month, from year to year, from generation to generation. Can anyone deny it? That they come and eat. Look, when there are massacres, wholesale killings of Muslims in the Holy Land, and when they are thinking about a replay of 1948 and 1967, when they expel Muslims en masse from their homes and from their homelands, these are the thoughts now that they are trying to implement. What do they do once they meet in Cairo, you know, months ago, and they said, we should give our Palestinian brothers some money, $1 billion. Is there any follow-up to that? You Muslims, you're supposed to be enlightened in the world. Is there any follow-up to this? How many have our victimized brethren received from their majesties and their excellencies? There's no follow-up. Supposed to be some Muslim lobby around here? Some Muslim political action committee? What are they? Speak to us! Tell us! And then they meet again in Amman. And before that, a larger group of them from Muslim countries met in Qatar. What has come of all of this? They meet and they dismiss us. An indication of Allah's words of truth. فَأَطَاعُوا إِنَّهُمْ كَانُوا قَوْمًا فَاسِقِينَ. What's the description of people who are vulnerable to the sliding hands of the Pharaoh? فُسُوق. We set ourselves up for qualifying for قَوْمٍ فَاسِقِينَ. Does it bother anyone to say the truth? You think what is happening, all of this is happening to people who are not fasiqeen. Everything is calling us. All the developments around us are a pressure on us to begin to think of what Allah is instructing us to do. Allah doesn't want you to come and fall asleep during the Jumu'ah khutbah once a week, to listen to nonsense. Even though millions of Muslims do that every week, this is the force and the effect of tradition. When Jumu'ah prayer itself has become a tradition, or even a folklore, it's part of your traditional character. It's no longer an institution that is able to generate public opinion and mold public opinion. Even though we have all of these catastrophes and calamities
surrounding us. We still have pathetic. We still have indifferent. We still have passive people who come to the masjid and then can't wait for the moment to be released and go back to their dunya. وَإِذَا رَأَوْا تِجَارَةً أَوْ لَهْوًا انْفَضُّوا إِلَيْهَا وَتَرَكُوكَ قَائِمًا قُلْ مَا عِندَ اللَّهِ خَيْرٌ مِنَ اللَّهْوِ وَمِنَ التِّجَارَةِ وَاللَّهُ خَيْرُ الرَّازِقِينَ. And if they see, this is in the context of Jumu'ah prayers, if they set a business opportunity, if they sense a time of leisure, they will part immediately from you, O Prophet of Allah, and leave you in your affairs alone to struggle with them. Say to them, what Allah has is better than the commercial activity that you are engaged in. And that the commercial activity necessarily as it impacts you as an individual, but the commercialism in this world that has even Muslim scholars speaking about the fitness of being practical, the fitness of being reasonable. That's another way of saying we have to toe the line of the economic interests in the world and not be against the status quo and not rock the boat. You see how the Pharaoh has penetrated, has become down on us in the political language of the world that we are in and in the religious discourse of our masjid, of our khatib, of our preachers who are supposed to know better. Where is the Torah that the Prophet spoke about in his final hajj? Yeah, you say that? You Muslims, you say that? You can say, you can express, you can talk, you can verbalize as much as you want these words. That doesn't count. What counts is action. And if the action is Muslim, lives are cheap. The Prophet is saying Muslim life is expensive. And the Kuffar and the Mushriks are saying Muslim life is cheap. Where are you in all of this? Have you ever given it a thought? Look at what the Prophet is saying. Look at what the Catholics are doing. And in between, look at these status quo scholars and how they are giving legitimacy to the conditions that we are in. Granted, there are old people. There are people who it's too late to have this Quran touch bases with them. But there's the young. There are the restless who qualify to know these meanings. And not to know them in a passive sense, but to know them as a matter of responsibility, as a matter of duty. We have this responsibility calling on us. And where are you in all of this? You take an example of our presence here. Look at the Muslims in this area, Washington, D.C., over 100,000, mashallah. Quantity and numbers are growing exponentially. Does any one of them personally say to them where to go to do our prayers or how to think about Islam? No. That's been taken care of in a more complex way. There are indirect ways of penetrating the Muslim mind and the Muslim psyche. that renders us what we are today, an opportunity like this to express Muslims in this area can express their determination. In these suburban areas, comfortably listening, even breathing through a khutbah, falling asleep, if they are not mentally asleep, they are physically asleep during this time. This is what Allah wants, but this is the effect that seeps down from the highest office of the land and makes its presence known even in the masjid and even in Mecca. إِنَّ فِرْعَوْنَ وَهَامَانَ وَجُنُودَهُمَا كَانُوا خَاطِئِينَ إِنَّ فِرْعَوْنَ عَلَا فِي الْأَرْضِ وجعل أهلها شيعا يستضعف طائفة منهم يذبح أبناءهم ويستحيي نساءهم إنه كان من المفسدين. And then Allah says, after experiencing all of this, not knowing it, after experiencing all of this, Allah says, ونريد أن نمن على الذين استضعفوا في الأرض. And we want to favor those who have been without power in the world. Allah wants you, but it seems like all indications are that you do not want Him. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم وادعوه سبحانه وأنتم على يقين بالإجابة وتوبوا إلى الله إن الله تواب رحيم غافر الذنب وقابل التوب شديد العقاب وإليه المصير. الحمد لله وكفى. الحمد لله الذي هدى الحمد لله حمدا يوافي نعمه ويكافئ مزيده. Brothers and sisters, know that when the Muslims felt the responsibility of their Islam, there was only one power that they felt accountable to, and that is the power of Allah. There was only one source of mercy that they were intent on securing, and that is Allah. To them, the wider issues of worldly and earthly powers here and there that did not factor in to their behavior and their tactics and their strategy. And there, how much any other force in the world had accumulated power, because they knew that power is the sole possession of Allah. They did not go about saying, we have to win Roman public opinion to our cause, or Muslim public opinion to our cause, or Catholic public opinion to our cause. What happened to today's Muslims? Why is it that they brought in to the Muslims' relationship with Allah other power, worldly and earthly power features? If it's power, they want it from these earthly sources. If it's affection, they want it from these earthly quislings. If it is admiration, they also want it from these earthly beings. What happened to Allah in all of this? Allah is just a secular God? Just a deity that you remember once a week? Or out of the 24 hours a day, 30 minutes in your salah during the day? Is this your relationship with Allah? And if it is, are you surprised that we are where we are today? Should there be a new human Muslim, new Islamic fiber, a new Islamic will that only deals with Allah? Isn't this the character of Allah's prophet? When Musa found that the forces of the world were going against him, he said, "In here, in that fit, let go. But it is only a fitna for you." This is a statement of intense meaning. When the prophet, the last prophet of Allah, found himself in conditions similar to those, he said, "Allahumma ilayka ashku. Oh Allah, I complain to you." When I look into our leaders, when we find ourselves in these types of conditions, they hop around the world because they find divinities and deities and authorities in the capital, in the palaces, in the mansions of this world. They no longer find it in the masjid. And then, either you are part of the problem or you're part of the solution. There's no area in between. And because the mainstream of today's masjid goers are part of the problem, then you can understand why we have what is happening to us. And it is only for the purpose of stimulating us. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا إِذَا مَسَّهُمْ طَائِفٌ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ تَذَكَّرُوا فَإِذَا هُمْ مُبْصِرُونَ رَبَّنَا أَفْرِغْ عَلَيْنَا صَبْرًا وَثَبِّتْ أَقْدَامَنَا وَانصُرْنَا عَلَى الْقَوْمِ الْكَافِرِينَ اللهم إليك نشكو ضعف قوتنا وقلة حيلتنا وهوانا على الناس يا أرحم الراحمين أنت ربنا وأنت رب المستضعفين. فإلى من تكلنا؟ إلى غريب يتجهمنا، أم إلى عدو ملكته أمرنا؟ إن لم يكن بك علينا غضب فلا نبالي، ولكن عافيتك هي أوسع لنا. نعوذ بنور وجهك الذي أشرقت له الظلمات وطلع عليه أمر الدنيا والآخرة، من أن تنزل بنا غضبك أو تحل علينا سخطك. لك العتبى حتى ترضى، ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بك. ربنا صل على محمد وآل محمد، ربنا بارك على محمد وآل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم، وباركت على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم في العالمين، إنك حميد مجيد. والعصر، إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. ومن أظلم ممن منع مساجد الله أن يذكر فيها اسمه وسعى في خرابها؟ أولئك ما كان لهم أن يدخلوها إلا خائفين، لهم في الدنيا خزي ولهم في الآخرة عذاب عظيم. إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي، يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. ولذكر الله أكبر. اذكروا الله يذكركم واشكروا له ولا تكفروه، وأقم الصلاة، إن الصلاة كانت على المؤمنين كتابا موقوتا.
الله أكبر الله أكبر، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله. حي على الصلاة، حي على الفلاة، قد قامت الصلاة، قد قامت الصلاة. الله أكبر الله أكبر، لا إله إلا الله.
Straight lines, please, heart with heart and shoulder to shoulder. صلوا الصلاة مودع. Pray and consider it your final صلاة.
الله أكبر. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا صراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ألهاكم التكاثر حتى زرتم المقابر، كلا سوف تعلمون، ثم كلا سوف تعلمون، كلا لو تعلمون علم اليقين، لترون الجحيم ثم لترونها عين اليقين ثم لتسألن يومئذ عن النعيم. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل يا أيها الكافرون لا أعبد ما تعبدون ولا أنتم عابدون ما أعبد ولا أنا عابد ما عبدتم ولا أنتم عابدون ما أعبد لكم دينكم ولي دين. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر.
أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. لا إله إلا الله إله واحد ونحن له مسلمون. لا إله إلا الله ولا نعبد إلا إياه مخلصين له الدين ولو كره المشركون. لا إله إلا الله ربنا ورب آبائنا الأولين. لا إله إلا الله وحده 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 أنت ذا وعده ونصر عبده وعز جنده وهزم الأحزاب وحده. فله الملك وله الحمد يحيي ويميت ويميت ويحيي وهو حي لا يموت بيد الخير وهو على كل شيء قدير.